2.2. New patch on the PTR today, 2.2. Download while I watch this play your way, 2.2. Copy over all my characters, 2.2. Battle ready gleaming crusaders, 2.2. Crazy drop rate made me grind again, 2.2. Nine ball sends me a request for friends, 2.2. Rollin' set is pretty crazy now, 2.2. Billion damage crits, I don't know how, 2.2. Now we're playing on the barb and it's 2.2. Spinning, whirling, yes, I think it fits, 2.2. Oh wait, I am in my IK set, 2.2. IK set, yes, I said IK set, 2.2. I bet you're tired of this dumb intro, 2.2. Westmarch Workshop, here's your favorite show.
Yeah. So, welcome to episode 42 of the Westmarch Workshop. I think it's titled Patch 2.2, in case you couldn't get the cue from that intro. The answer for everything.
The answer for everything.
Because 42 is life, 42 is love.
Yeah,
did
42.
Did I get it right?
you're close enough. There'll be someone out there will get that joke. I put so much time and effort into crafting the title for the episode.
Right.
It was episode 42. You had to do something special for it, right?
Of course. It's a horse, of course. Oh, boy. So, yeah. For those who don't know, the internet was born on the first day. And then on the second day, they made Tazon Day. And on the third day, he brought us chocolate rain.
Yes.
That is the history of the world, or of the internet.
Mm-hmm. And if you don't know what chocolate rain is, you're too young to be watching this show.
Mm-hmm. Then you should go to sleep now.
Yeah, it is past your bedtime.
Oh, yeah. So I had to take it back there a little bit. For those who don't know, I'm a big Hearthstone fan, and Tazon Day actually streams Hearthstone. So he has converted himself from a YouTube personality to a Twitch personality. And he stands all stream long. And plays Hearthstone and uses his beautiful baritone voice to talk about the cards.
I actually did not know that.
Oh, there you go.
You just blew my mind.
Today you learned.
Today I learned.
Yeah, man, you should check it out sometime. It's actually really entertaining.
They should just add like a chocolate rain emote for him.
Yes, we need that.
When he goes right before he does like lethal damage on the board, he can just click it and it just starts raining down chocolate.
I love it. We need to contact Twitch admins immediately.
Immediately.
Immediately. But yeah, he is not the best Hearthstone player. But that aside, Nineball, let's talk about your trials and tribulations and successes in gaming.
Yes, my successes in gaming this week actually was offline. It was in this thing called the real world. Because I had the great opportunity that there was a couple people that had come down to Florida. Twiz, who's also a member of BlizzPro, and he does the Hearthstone Power Hour and the Heroes Power Hour, which you can also catch me on Tuesday nights at 9 p.m. Eastern, or sorry, 10 p.m. Eastern, and 10 p.m., 9 p.m. Central, 10 p.m. Eastern.
There it is.
But as well as DJ Dreadscythe, who does the Scythe and Shield podcast and also is a member of BlizzPro, helps us out. He did the wonderful overlay that you see on the screen right now. They were both in Orlando the same weekend. And so it was a short trip up. It was only about 3 hours away from where I'm at. So I had to make the trip up there to go through and try and see these guys. And unfortunately, we wanted to go and leave Friday so that we might have a chance to see Twiz, because he was at a work convention.
Oh, okay.
But things got a little bit out of hand, and we weren't able to make the trip up on Friday. So I had to end up going on Saturday. And We got up there, we saw some friends. Twiz was still busy, so unfortunately things didn't quite work out. We weren't able to go and meet up with him, but we did go over to Downtown Disney and have dinner with DJ Dreadscythe Robert, and you know, had a lot of fun there, Kat and I. And then he and his wife were there, and you know, just sat around, chat, talked about video games, Diablo, and just, you know, nerded out at Disney. So that was, it was a nice, pleasant weekend. But all the traveling and such did kind of limit the time that I had to go and play with in game in the Diablos. Mm-hmm. So, but yeah, they had a lot of fun going out there and connecting with some other people in the community.
That's cool, man. It's always nice to see, you know, when you can take all the connections that you make through the game and through the internet and whatnot and realize them in actual life. You know, it mm-hmm. kind of gives it that 3D feel to it, you know, almost. It's, mm-hmm. it's kind of like it's beyond your screen now, you know?
Yeah, and that's one thing that, like, in all my years of gaming that I really enjoyed the most about, say, World of Warcraft, was you go on, you make these relationships and you connect with these people and you talk with them on a daily basis and you spend a lot of time with them. The only thing that you don't do is you don't, like, see their face or interact with them directly. But when you actually have that opportunity to finally, you know, sit down, I've never met this person before. And, you know, there's no awkwardness about it. You go through and you have, you know, like a 3-4 hour conversation. You just, you know, nonstop talking as if, you know, you just, you know, met up for drinks on the weekend.
Right.
You know,
and it's something you always did.
Yeah, exactly. It's just like one of those great things how, you know, even though the world is pretty big, the just gaming in general, you can really make those connections with someone from, you know, on the other side of the globe.
True story, man. True story. Mm-hmm. I love that about this thing. And that, trying to segue into my gaming weekend gaming. I always say gaming weekend. I don't know why. It sounds better that way to clear it. So,
gaming of the week.
Gaming of the week, indeed. Let me think. I didn't meet any people. Actually, oh, I have a great transition. So I was supposed to go to PAX East and mm-hmm. meet JR and all sorts of people. Mm-hmm. And then I got sick. And I actually had taken the Friday off of work, and work was actually super accommodating. So thumbs mm-hmm. up for the new job. You guys rock.
Nice, nice.
So they let me get the day off, but then I woke up and was just like hit with a fever. And I kind of felt it coming on Thursday. Mm-hmm. So I felt, you know, if I got sleep, I figured I could root it a little bit. But that did not happen. And I missed the whole convention.
You're supposed to get the PAX pox after the convention.
No, dude, I hacked it.
You're doing it wrong.
I got it. I got that early release.
The one thing you don't want to
get. Right? So. I don't want alpha access to this. What ended up happening, though, was I was okay enough to sit up and play some Diablo, naturally. Mm-hmm. So I did that, and I think it was fate saying, you should have just gotten out of the house, toughed it out, taken the Boston commute. Because I died on Sunday. My Crusader that I've been playing hardcore on, mm-hmm. hardcore, got a DC while trying to level up some gems. It was a very, very long DC, maybe like 20 seconds or so. And it came back and there was no hope, no hope at all. Mm-hmm. So kind of a bit of a bummer, put a pause on my conquests or supposed conquests that I was planning, and it kind of gave me a bit of perspective to take a step back from playing super all in, kind of get some other life things going out for runs now and stuff, feeling good, mm-hmm. balancing it out, and actually stepping into the PTR. So I have PTR infos for everyone, which I'm really excited to talk about once we get there. And yeah, it's been all right, you know. Handled the death. I did have a backup Crusader. I put the gear on and it looks okay, but it'll never quite be the same, you know?
Yeah. It's good that you're channeling your inner necromancer and just trying to find the balance of all things.
There it is, man. Mm-hmm. If it's not going to be in the game, then you got to make it happen somehow, right?
Yes. The necromancer will be in all of our hearts in one way or another.
There it is. All right. So enough sad things. Let's move on to happier, more exciting things.
Yes, let's go. So we have quite a few things to talk about that's happened in the past week.
It's a flurry of news right now. I love it.
I guess one of the first things that came about last week was, of course, Nevelistus's Play Your Way, which this time was a Play Your Way Friday instead of a Play Your Way Thursday.
Crazy.
Yep, and we went and we got to have the live stream. And this one was a little bit interesting. One, it was the very first time that a wizard actually showed up for the Play Your Way stream, so that was a first.
Imagine that they do exist.
Yep, and then also this time, instead of having one of the actual game designers itself, we got someone from a different side of the development team. Was Roger Houston, I believe his name was, and he is actually a software engineer. Not one of the ones that does like the balancing of numbers and the creating of the sets and things like that, but he does a lot of like the back end work of actually getting the engine itself up and running and doing the tests and all the mechanics that actually makes the game run.
Yeah, it was really cool to hear him start to speak about some of the things he does behind the scenes, and it was just really cool to kind of get that different perspective, to have it not be someone that's concerned primarily with, like you said, balancing the numbers or, introducing new items to the game, but actually making the presentation happen on the screen. And I actually wanted almost it to be an extended kind of stream, or they just stop playing and let him talk, because I wanted to hear about. He was talking at some points, like, he's saying there's a lot of tricks that go on behind what you're actually seeing to make the game show you what you see. And I was kind of wondering, like, what do you mean by that? Like, when I cast, a condemn, is it actually not like casting over there? Like, is it over here, and then you have to do some crazy hitbox thing? Like, I'm really curious about all that stuff, so.
Yeah, I mean one of the interesting things that I found was, some of the abilities like what is it? Magic missile. Actually it uses the same exact coding as Disintegrate and Ray of Frost.
Which is crazy.
That apparently, it's like in but when you think about it, you can see it because all that magic missile really is, it's like, just a half second channel of a beam. As it just shoots out in one direction and it stops, at the first thing that it hits.
Super cool, man.
Yeah.
Stuff you don't think about. But yeah, so I when I my general appreciation of this stream was just that it felt like the most lax of the ones that they've had so far, and it was I enjoyed it for that, because A, it was Friday night, coming home, from work and whatnot, so it was nice to just kind of kick back. And there were like some really good jokes in there. I felt like PR Fly was like a really cool personality. He's just kind of like saying whatever came to his head. I loved
Yeah.
it. Just hold no punches.
No, he did not. He was very animated. I liked his takes on a lot of the things. Definitely brought a level of dang it, what's the word that I'm looking for? Never mind, move on.
I don't know, charisma?
No, it was it's like relaxation, casualness.
Casual.
It made it seem as if it was just like it was really a conversation.
Yeah. I think that's what they've been driving for in the different iterations of this player way. When it started out, there was a lot of that criticism, like, are you really theorycrafting anything? You're just talking about people's favorite builds and blah blah blah. And it feel like it finally has made kind of that turn to being just more about like friends getting together, and just having fun and talking about the game as ideas and things come to mind. So I think they're starting to hit their mission statement there. And it.
And it's funny just thinking about that. And this is kind of, we're getting at that point in time as we're getting close to the Reaper of Souls anniversary, and then after that, the Diablo 3 anniversary. It's kind of like the retrospective period of going and looking back, well, all the criticisms when it was Theorycraft Thursday. It was like, oh, these are joke builds. These are, you can't go and compete in Torment 6 with these builds and such. And so they changed the name to Play Your Way Thursday. And even though some of those criticisms still go and pop up, it's like, is this a Torment 6 or a Torment 4 build? But they've like become, practically non-existent. You see a couple of them, but now people are going and talking about the build or throwing in ideas or just enjoying the conversation instead of criticizing it just based on what it's called.
It's that whole judge a book by its cover, etc., etc. You know, like there's stuff to be gained from every production of anything that's Diablo. That's why I feel like when people, and maybe this should be an after show talking point, but when we talk about streams and the popularity of streams and all that good stuff, I feel like people should just scroll to the bottom. Like go when you're on Twitch, just go to the bottom and watch someone that has like three viewers. You may find a diamond in the rough. Like there, I don't know. To me, it just seems like you should never, because something is labeled what it is, or because something has a certain reputation, you shouldn't necessarily take that to mean that's the value that that thing has, because it can mean different things to different people, and different people get different enjoyment out of stuff. So, were there many or any things that you wanted to particularly point out about the player way?
I mean, there was some other interesting things about they're still like working on the focus and restraint tweaks. Some of the other ones that we went through and saw is just, so the set changes, there's still going to be set changes, which, we since that cast, we now have a lot of those changes in the PTR build that came out yesterday. But yeah, this one was definitely a lot more of a laid back, play your way, and they talk a lot more about like mechanics than go on in the actual game itself than like skill mechanics. So they talk about mechanics, but not mechanics, if that makes sense.
Oh, totally. I'm with you.
Totes.
Totes my goats. But no, I think in my summary is similar to yours. I just hope that they do keep not only a diversity of people and personalities and sorts that they bring on who win, but also on the other side too, the Blizzard employee side. I would love to see, if they can get some more, I don't know, story people or artists who can talk about different things that we're seeing in the game too, just to keep it fresh and interesting.
Yeah, and of course, and we forgot to mention that there was Jace was on the stream as
How
well.
could we forget Jace? Come
Yes,
on.
yes, yeah. And I was going through and like speaking of artists, I think it was it dang it, I think his name was Neil from last year's anniversary stream for Diablo 2, the barrel guy.
Oh, the barrel guy. I can't remember
Yeah.
his name. He'll just forever be known as the barrel
Yeah, pretty
guy.
much. It's like you just remember him as the barrel guy. If they could get him to go back on and talk about that on a Play Your Way.
Please.
So they've got so many interesting people on the development team from so many different aspects. You have someone that goes through and it's like, I make barrels, and his take on the game and his perspective of being on the team. You get to know a lot about what goes on behind the scenes.
Agreed.
And I think that's one of the things that I guess really happened this weekend is we got to see a lot of different aspects of Diablo 3, its development and what the team itself has gone through. Because in addition to the Play Your Way, also on Friday there was the GDC conference that Josh went through and talked about Friday morning, and this one was like another retrospective on the development of Reaper of Souls, but it seemed to be a lot more in depth and a lot more focused chat than what we saw at BlizzCon. The evolving Reaper of Souls, even though a lot of the things that he said, he had said at the previous BlizzCon panel, he, went a lot deeper and a lot more emotional in this conversation.
We were having a pre-discussion about this, and you really could get that feel of just how important this game is to the development team. One of the things that stood out for me from that talk in particular was when he was talking about the build up to the release of the game and them getting really excited. They've been sitting with that baby for years at that point. And the most exciting part for a developer is supposed to be when they release the game. For the most part, the work is done. And of course, there'll be patches, of course, there'll be updates, etc. But the game is out there. It's in the hands of the players that have been clamoring and waiting and patiently waiting for it for years. And then he said, the game was released, and instead of jubilation and happiness, there were just sad developers everywhere. Like he would walk through the offices, and people were just like, "How did this happen?" All the errors and getting logging in, and then all the criticism that was heaped, because it got great critical acclaim from all the like the mags and the reviewers and the PC gamer and whatever have you. But when it got into the hands of the players,
Yeah,
that
because
was.
they went and showed like the Metacritic score, and it's like, oh, so amazing, and then the player score, and it was abysmal.
22 or something out of 100.
Yeah.
Crazy low. And it's funny that you mentioned before we started this particular topic, just how it really is starting to become that time of year for looking back, and we're coming up on the anniversaries of the expansion and the full game itself. And it was kind of cool that the timing for this GDC also lined up with that too, because you could take that trip down memory lane with him and think about, some of those postmarks when they added Paragon and how that kind of helped to prop the system back up a little bit when they added Monster Power. And of course that moment that he loves to talk about in the game, and everyone loves to rally around, that fateful meeting where Josh is silent and Morheim looks at him and says, "Hey, you haven't said anything about this auction house thing. What are we gonna do?" So yeah, it was awesome to just kind of like relive that timeline, and then also to put it into comparison, because at this point he could talk about, and he did a little bit about the 2.2 stuff and the coming sets and things like that, and that was part of it at BlizzCon, but not as much, because now we know a lot more than we did back then.
Yeah, it's one thing that I really recommend that anyone that's interested in Diablo, in the just beyond just the game itself, and you really care about the game and want to know more about like what the team went through, that you should check this one out. It gets pretty emotional at times when he's going and talking about it, like you mentioned about how the team just was like defeated. You know, the game came out and they should be happy and celebrating, but no, it was just nothing but, misery walking through the halls. And, like also you mentioned the meeting with Mike Morheim. We at BlizzCon, we knew that it was a meeting and a discussion that they had, and that was kind of like, I think that we should go through and remove it. Well, this meeting was going and talking about how to further expand upon it and build upon it, and like the lawyers were there and the from the legal team and all that, and how they're going to go through and push it forward. And just that quick conversation turned into, let's do it. And then just a few days later, they made the announcement that we're getting rid of it, that it was just like a snap decision,
No, it's really cool that they seemed, so willing and so ready to listen to Josh and to just say, "All right, we're gonna go with in this direction." Because, yeah, you reminded me of another point. They were talking about how with Hearthstone and then Heroes coming up, they were gonna have to do some back end things to change the money transactions and all that stuff. So yeah, it was really at that point where they're like, "We're either gonna go full bore with this thing or not." And obviously we know the road they chose, and I think it kind of the whole emotional side of it gives you another way to be invested in this game, to see what the devs went through, and obviously to have experienced it as a player, but then to see them rally and to see them keep building and building until we have this amazing thing that is Reaper of Souls now, and all the patches that have come along with that too. And we're still going, there's still
Oh
more
yeah.
coming.
Still a lot more coming.
So it's super exciting.
Yeah, and I mean, patch 2.2, even though this is huge, 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 huge. There's more coming, after this. They still have more to work on. They will gotten they have more balancing to do. I'm sure that they'll go through and we'll get additional sets. We've got more sets coming, hopefully, for the other classes besides just the three new ones that we got this time.
Right on. Yeah, man. It's a good time to be a Diablo player. And I think for the people that have maybe just stepped back in and missed a lot of that history, or only picked it up after Reaper, like this GDC can kind of help to bridge the gap for you and kind of understand what we were all going through from day one. And I did have on screen there. This is for the people just listening. If you want to check out diablo.blizzpro.com. I did write an article on it, so you can get some links to the video and whatnot over there. And I also wanted to take this quick moment. I know this isn't on our list of things, but I wanted to announce that we have a new writer who is also a member of our clan, and that's how he actually met all of us, which is really cool. But Lieutenant Lunatic put up this ZDPS Witch Doctor article just a few days ago, and that was his official introduction to the Diablo BlizzPro writing staff. So if you guys give him a warm welcome, follow him on Twitter, all that good stuff, check out that article. It's a really good one.
Yeah, and it talks not just about like the ZDPS Witch Doctor build, but ZDPS builds in general and the impact it's going to have on the game going forward.
And he's got a lot more stuff like that, similar ideas and things coming. So Stuff to look forward to.
Yeah.
Where did we want to go from here?
I mean, going on from this point, we've had two patches to the PTR over this past week. The first one came last week and didn't really make that many waves. It was more of a performance patch that they kind of tweaked some things in the back end of how the game processes and works on the PTR. But that led to some huge performance increases for a lot of players. Now, that's something that I've kind of noticed. On my computer on Act 3 maps, with anything that has multiple streams of lava pouring down in the background, I start having some serious frame rate issues where the game runs perfectly fine everywhere else. And this one seems to have, gone through and fixed that one for me, at least, and there's been a lot of people that have going through and saying that all of their frame rate issues have stopped.
Wow.
And so this one seems to have been, really big in that respect, that it's helped out a lot of people with just how well the game itself plays. I guess they fixed some memory loopholes or anything like that was causing artifacting or the frames to drop.
Right. First, I wanted to just say that I lava you. I think I needed to throw that out there. And, number two,
is it lava or magma?
How can I magma you?
I don't know. Well, we're underneath the surface.
Oh, I see. You're like magma. Technically asking.
Yeah.
I took geology back in the day. I remember nothing.
Mm-hmm. Good.
So I got that going.
All right.
Which is nice. What was I going to say now? I missed my actual point, but I think mostly I was just going to say that, oh yes, I was going to ask you, do you believe that this has anything to do with this new file system, the CASC? Do you think it's an optimization that they made with this patch through, just getting the files lined up, or do you think that was intended in terms of them moving to this file system, getting rid of some of that frame stuff eventually?
I have absolutely no idea. Huh. So I'm going to say yes.
I did not expect that turn.
Yeah, I have no idea on this side of how the game runs and how the engine works and such. That's just, the suggestions and the speculation that I've seen other people discussing on the internet, and that's something I'm inclined to agree with at that point. It makes sense. I have no evidence whatsoever to back up that claim, though.
Right on. We'll have to meet with some sort of expert on these things. Like, what do you know? But if more than anything, again, just more future excitement. I feel like that is the theme of right now. Is the future looks super bright. So many good things are coming.
Yeah, definitely. Definitely. And of course, there's also this other little patch that I guess no one really cares about that came out yesterday that did a whole bunch of class changes, that changed set bonuses and things of that nature.
I saw it. I glanced over it. I was like, whatever. Cool.
yeah, whatever. What? I guess we could talk about it.
We should, just to be thorough,
Yeah.
People might care.
Yeah, so I guess for those that are still interested, they added in a patch yesterday that they implemented a lot of changes they had been talking about, particularly set balancing to try and, bring some of the sets that were underperforming compared to the top builds to bring them back in line, or at least to try and make them compete. Particularly, one of the things I had mentioned in the previous episode is the two new Demon Hunter sets were falling short of the mark. They still weren't performing as well as the Marauders set was, so they buffed them. And the same is said for a lot of the other classes as well, making slight tweaks to numbers or changing functionality in different ways to make them better, to make it so that way you actually want to go through and use these sets and you don't feel as if you're gimping yourself to try something new.
Yeah, I think that's important to talk about just because it's something we've been kind of reiterating on in each and every episode. Is just, these sets have benchmarks that they're competing against, because we all know and love this stuff. Love is a relative term, but we all at least know the stuff that we're using right now and its proficiency, its efficiency, etc. So at at the point when you're introducing brand new things, of course people want to try them because they're shiny and new. But at the end of the day, the numbers have to perform. Like, people will go back to the old stuff when the game is live if it's going to get them to the highest grade or rift, and if that's what they're focused on. Obviously, some people like play for fun, and that's completely valid. And so the new sets could be fun for them, and that's what they gravitate towards. But I think you have to definitely cater towards both sides, make the set fun to play, but also make it competitive because there's no point in introducing new items if no one uses them.
And this also ties in slightly with one of the other changes that we've noticed with this patch, is they actually started season three on the PTR. So we got to see the new, all the new perks as well as the new conquests. Now, obviously, these conquests are works in progress that they very well could change. But one of the conquests was, in fact, that you had to beat Greater Rift 40 using three different class sets. Now, every class has the opportunity to complete it by themselves because they added in three different sets for each class as part of this achievement. So pretty much all of the old sets, none of the new ones that were added in. But as they have to make it you have to make it at least a little bit fair to so that way they don't want you to try and actually go and say complete Greater Rift 40 in the old Helltooth set, which it still needs some work because I don't think that one is one that's been touched and it's on there, which is probably as bad as trying to complete Greater Rift 40 in the Shadow's Mantle, which has absolutely no DPS bonus whatsoever and is entirely a survival set.
Right. I think we all have
Yes.
a bone to pick here because the Crusaders are left with their third set of, oh, what's that? Let me look through this list. Right, Thorns of the Invoker. After Travis has literally said, "I give up on this set. This is what we have to go through and beat it with." And Nineball's talking about like rolling new classes and stuff. I'm like, "What is that?" I thought they deleted the other classes.
This Steven's gone a little bit insane when he goes and clicks on character creation. It's just Crusader, 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 Crusader.
It's for
It's the only
efficiency's
thing.
sake.
Yeah, pretty much. It's the only thing that he sees when he goes and clicks to create a new character. But it'll be interesting. I don't know if they have any plans to buff some of these sets to actually make them, viable. Props to the person that decides that I'm going to go and get this achievement using nothing but the Shadow's Mantle, Helltooth Harness in the Thorns of the Invoker. If someone does that,
That is
you're awesome.
ultimate respect. You have to put a photo on Reddit, and then literally everyone should just give you a internet high five because that would be insane.
Pretty much, pretty much. It's just for a lot of people that are going to be going for that, I imagine you'll probably see them kind of drifting towards just leveling multiple classes.
I think that's got to be the intention here. Of course, you can hopefully do it with your one class. But I think what they're aiming for is a bit of diversity, having a reason to re-roll and get rewarded for it, and a reason to kind of learn another class. Because getting to Greater Rift 40 isn't, a wake up and do it kind of task. Like, you have to know what your build is, kind of inside out, some of the strengths of the different sets and whatnot, and how to put it all together. Because at that level, you do have to operate your character well enough to stay, especially for hardcore, to stay alive and get the job done. And then you were also looking at some of the other things implemented here too, like this gem, the Bane of the Stricken.
Oh yeah, that one. I think I found Lieutenant Lunatic's favorite gem for season three. That this one, it's every time that you go through and attack something, you put a debuff on it, which increases all of your attack's damage on it by 10%. I unfortunately I didn't get it on the PTR. My time to play it was very limited. I kind of just logged in and took some screenshots and ran around Act 3 to seeing if my performance had increased. So I'm sorry. Not sorry. But I don't know what the scaling on it will be. I'm going to imagine probably around 1%
I got your
per
back.
level.
You are absolutely right. Oh wait, no, hold on. Are you right? I'm
Am
looking
I
at a
right?
different gem. Keep going.
Okay.
I'll get back to you.
I imagine it's probably going to be around 1% because that makes the 10% kind of per rank up is it's kind of average across some of the gyms.
You're right. It's 1%.
Okay, there we go. And then at the 25, at the level 25 unlock, it makes it so that way that bonus is also applied to your pets, your followers, and allied players. So this is actually going to be a bigger DPS increase than the Toxin Gem, because you're going to be able to get a massive damage boost on everything that you hit. So you can go through and you use Toxin in Bane of the Stricken and be applying a huge damage bonus, you know, to everyone else in your party for those DPS builds.
It's pretty awesome, man. And we were talking about, again, in the pre-ish show, just the fact that it's great to see Blizzard supporting the playstyle. And I was kind of mumbling around in my head, like, why would they not want to? Because it's a diversity, you know, it's another way to play the same class that you might already know and love. But it's so cool to see now, like, you take the defensive gems from Season 2 and you say, all right, my job is just to stay alive, support my group, and cast my debuffs, my buffs, whatever. But this gem and something like the Gem of Efficacious Toxin can actually help you turn the tide in terms of, okay, do we need to stay alive and are my buffs good enough, or do we actually just need straight up more damage, and then I'll try and do my best to use my debuffs and things like that. Mm-hmm. So you have options within this niche playstyle. This is amazing. Like, the level that you'll be able to take some of these very specific roles is really cool. So you're going to see some really developed multiplayer gameplay.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and this one will be interesting just for the fact that, you know, because it also applies to your pets once you hit level 25, and it scales by 1%, that's going to be better than Bane of the Trapped or the Enforcer Gem.
Yeah.
Yeah, because even though it starts off worse, it will get better.
It gets better.
Yeah, even though, you know, this combined with Bane of the Trapped for classes that have easy access to slows or cold damage is going to be huge. That you know can take the place of Bane of the Trap for a pet build, because you can use Enforcer so that way to keep your pets alive, and then Bane of the Stricken for your debuff to increase your damage.
Very interesting. I guess the one thing I wonder with Bane of the Trapped versus this is, because we know that Bane of the Trapped is a multiplicative bonus, but mm-hmm. I'm assuming that this is just going to add to your weapon damage. And of course, that then gets multiplied through all the other parts too. So I guess, yeah, it probably would end up being a lot more.
Yeah.
It really
all depends on what your damage is, you know, compared to all of your bonuses.
I'm so excited, man.
Mm-hmm.
Oh boy, there were also there's a new potion that you can see on screen here called the Bottomless Potion of Amplification. Increases mm-hmm. the healing from all sources by a certain percent. Here it's 22% for 5 seconds. Seems interesting. Just kind of like if you're at the bottom of your life there, just you get more healing, potentially.
Yeah. That one I find is, even though they went in this patch, they're buffing all of the healing potions. They're greatly increasing the life on hit, life per second, and the life on kill bonuses for the potions. I think this could very easily take the cake, depending upon how much life on hit and life per second that you have.
That's true. Because, you know, even if you have, 20, if it's, I imagine the low roll here is like 20% for 5 seconds, mm-hmm. and you have, what's like an average normal number of life per second, like 10K?
Yeah.
So then 20% of that is what, 2,000? I'm so bad at math on stream. So that's another... So yeah, you're up to 12,000, and that's just at the low end. Imagine if you are a ZDPS build, with you're stacking these things. Imagine if you just happen to have it on one or two affixes.
Yeah, because let's see, they buffed it to the, like, say the Bottomless Potion of Regeneration now gives you 75,000 to 100,000 life per second over 5 seconds. So that would be potentially regaining 500,000 health.
Well, you wouldn't be able to use both, right?
No, you wouldn't be able to use both, but I'm just going through and looking
at it. Oh, I get it. I get it. You're extrapolating.
Yeah, like, yeah, trying to math it out. Yeah, so that does have a... For one of those high rolls on that one, it's going to take a lot in order to try and match that.
Yeah, I guess it really depends kind of on... If you have a lot of it on gear and on Paragon and stuff like that, versus if you just want it all in your potion.
Yeah, you'd have to Yeah, you'd have to be doing close to like 2.5 million healing over 5 seconds to compare with that. So never mind.
To math it out.
Never mind. Yeah.
But I want you to dig into this thing that you have unearthed and now have enabled a new conspiracy theory on. So let's talk about this portrait frame and pennant.
They have the new portrait frame and pennant that they're adding in. In the previous seasons, we've gotten the banner background, sigil, and border, or sorry, accent to customize your banner, that thing that very few people ever use. This time they're changing up a little bit. You get a pennant and a portrait. This goes in line with the fact that they're adding in the new cosmetic window. So that way you can go through and change effects. The only other pennant in the game right now is the Warlords of Draenor, like Blademaster banner that you can click on and off, and you can have it with your wings. So this is just one extra, kind of like a transmog that you can add to your character as just a little,
Cosmetic
nice
piece.
cosmetic piece that you can add to your character. And this one is Diablo's head on a pike with a big the three banner or the three symbol going down the flag itself, and a really nicely done Diablo portrait. It looks really nice. It's just an extension of like the Paragon portraits and such. Gets rid of all those little annoying stars and what have you. And it's just one of those things that going through and thinking of that, along with the time frame that we're kind of expecting patch 2.2 and season 3 to drop. We also, I guess, kind of skipping ahead in the news a little bit, we got an announcement today that season 2 is ending soon. It's kind of a soon in quotations. They said they'll give us at least a 14-day warning before they end the season. But like with season 1, they kind of gave us that warning, about a month beforehand. With season 1, they said they would give us a 30-day warning, and they gave us that warning, a month before they gave us the warning. So it was like a warning of a warning. So it almost seems as if, we're about a month and a half away, or maybe 2 months away from season 2 ending. And that would almost perfectly peg it down to having patch 2.2 come out just a little bit before the Diablo 3 anniversary. Yeah, and this is just, the perfect cosmetic effects to add in for that occasion. It's to celebrate the Diablo 3 anniversary. Go play season 3, get to level 70, and now you can walk around with Diablo's head on a pike. What better way of going through and celebrating the anniversary than something like that? Quite a bit. There is no cow level. What are you talking about?
I was muted the whole time. I'm so
Oh no.
sorry. I'm so bad with my mute button now. Sorry about that, guys. All I was saying was I totally buy into Nineball's theory here. I think that after he mapped it out, it makes a lot of sense, and it works well in terms of celebrating that we've had 3 years of the original Diablo 3 being out. It creates the goal of having season two be much shorter than season one, by quite a bit, and it gets the patch 2.2 into the hands of players sooner rather than later. So I think this is going to be a thing. And
Yeah.
also cows moo.
And cows moo.
Just saying, never know.
So for the last like the 10 seconds, I was just talking to myself.
Yeah,
Just
you
dead
were.
air, just dead air time. I wasn't even
That's
responding.
all right.
But yeah. So some very interesting things going and coming up. But one of the other ones that going through and mentioning that this also would put it at about a 2 month PTR, which coincides with what previous PTRs have been.
Right. Oh,
So
I think it all makes sense.
I would not be surprised to see season two end. Want to say season two would probably end like the first week of May. We'll push it around like ending maybe like May 4th, maybe even April 27th, giving us like the 2 week breather in order to celebrate things, and then having season three drop on May 15th and just be like one huge celebration.
Is that a Tuesday?
No, it's a Friday.
It's a, is it a,
It
wow.
is a Friday.
Dude,
That's
this.
what, yeah, I forgot to mention that to you. It was one of the other things that was like kind of going all inside of it because seasons start on Fridays,
You're right.
and it's a Friday.
It's gotta
It, it's
happen.
it, it has to happen. It
It
absolutely has to
would be
happen.
a missed opportunity if it didn't happen.
Yep.
So.
So that's just one of those things. You heard it here from us right now. This is our speculation. Season three, May 15th,
Check
Diablo
back
three anniversary.
in 2 months.
Yeah, see where it happens, and then we can go back and link on Reddit. We said it, we said it,
We
we
did
called it,
it,
we did
Reddit.
it, and then everyone will be like, "Stop self-promoting your shadow ban."
And then we get banned from Reddit,
Yep.
lose all the credibility that we thought we had.
That we thought we had. Yep.
Any thoughts in terms of stuff that you noticed on PTR? I have a couple of random notes from my play session yesterday.
Just some of the things I'm really liking some of the new bounties that they've added in.
Oh, you tried some?
Yeah, I went through and tried some of the new bounties. One of them was bugging out on me in Act 3 as I was going and testing out the lava thing. I got it twice in the games that I was rolling, and you have to go through and destroy these little demonic shrines, and it has four shrines thrown out through Crater 2, and you have to click it, and it spawns some mobs for you to go through and defeat, and so that way you can destroy the shrine. And it's just so it gives you this thing that it's not just go here, kill this one thing, and kill 100 enemies on the way. You're actually actively looking for multiple objectives as you're going and clearing through. And I think that's just a lot more interesting. Even though it kind of accomplishes the same thing, walk around the zone, kill a bunch of enemies, and then kill this one big name enemy or whatever. But just because it breaks it up, you feel the progression as you're going and playing, and it just makes it feel better. It makes it feel as less of a grind because you're like, oh, I completed one shrine. Oh, there's a second shrine. Oh, there's a third shrine. Oh, there's a fourth shrine. I'm finally done.
Right, like
It
the
has it just it has that build up, and so it's that little reward as you're going through.
I like to call them process goals. So it's like the things that you earn on the way to the thing that you're trying to accomplish, the big thing you're trying to accomplish. I think that usually helps to just kind of make what you're doing feel more important, even though it's just the small step stuff to get you to where you need to be. So that's cool. I'm glad you tried them. I feel like most people in general, like the first thing when they get on the PTR is like, I want to do anything but bounties, you know? I'm so
Yeah.
tired of them already.
Yeah, which is one of those things that they added in. They put a lot of work into adding new bounties and new breaking bounties out into new zones, like the aqueducts in Act 2. And until they kind of fix the reward structure on bounties, it's only going to be like a novelty. You'll do it to try it out.
Yeah, and then you'll go back to Act One. I do hope.
Imagine a conquest, complete every bounty in the game
Dude, I
twice,
want
three
that.
times. Yeah.
I want that. That'd be so sick. All right. So, before I even get into some play stuff, play testing stuff, there's one patch note that came out yesterday that I feel like we're not quite celebrating as hard as we should right now. This patch note reads, and I quote, as soon as I scroll to it, I should have been more set up for this, but actually, I'm just building suspense here because this is the best thing ever. You can now increase your blood shard cap by achieving a personal best in solo greater rifts. The cap will be increased by 10 shards per greater rift completed. We did it!
We did it, guys.
We did it!
Yep.
After all of that chest thumping, languishing, women in the street dying, dogs running away from home, we finally did it. We got what we came for.
So, I mean, almost anyone should now at this point be capable of, grabbing 800 blood shards, 750 blood shards.
They're like around greater than 30,
Yeah, around
35.
greater if 30, for even if you just kind of play the game casually, most people are capable, maybe not in a season, but outside of seasons. I think everyone that is concerned about the blood shard limit should at least be able to handle greater if 30, giving you 800. And for those people that can go higher, more power to you.
Indeed. And think about that too, because the very first conquest for Greater Rifts was get to Greater Rift 30, and now we're looking at season 3. It's going to be get to Greater Rift 40. So the power creep is real, but yeah, I think 30 is a very plausible place to get to. And when you look at the prices, that's 10 two-handers, which is like way more than the three or four you could get before. Oh man. So yeah, it's just it feels like vindication. And it was obviously a change I think that they were on board with too, they being the devs. I think it was just how to express it. And this seems like a good way because it's merit-based. It's not just, log in one day and you have a 1,000 cap.
Yeah, and it's interesting how they've talked about wanting to take some of the focus away from Greater Rifts. They feel that too much of the game is built around Greater Rifts, and then they just added more focus to it.
I was
But
gonna say that to you, yeah. How about that?
it is nice that in addition to just going through and like saying, well, I have my personal best, I can do Greater Rift 34, but it doesn't even put me anywhere on the leaderboards. You still have a reward from it, something that you can go through and see. You might be able to level up your gyms a little bit here and there, but you can always get it higher by going in groups. But now you have something that you can go through and see. I earned this 900 blood shard cap.
Yep.
This is something that I physically got a reward from being able to do this.
Yeah, and it really does kind of call back to that moment that Wyatt was talking about where the game celebrates your achievement, Like this is a very visible way of saying, "Hey, you earned, X amount of blood shard cap because you conquered this greater rift." And I love that they limited it to solo. I think it's really good that they're starting to kind of realize that, some of these things are better done in groups. So if you want solo anything to mean anything, you have to kind of like lock that solo in there from the get-go. So I'm a happy boy. No.
I think everyone is happy with that
That's
change.
true.
The person that can only get to greater Rift 3 is probably happy with that change.
Seriously, though.
They can gamble one more item before they have to go back into before they have to or they can hold enough blood shards to gamble one additional item.
I love it. And yeah, like you were saying before at the start of this segment, just a ton of item changes. Some of the stuff that we were mentioning on the last show, like certain items that were being added to the sets were being changed to different slots. So like the Zuni legs became a belt, the gloves for the Demon Hunter in the Natalia set, actually, or they weren't part of the Natalia set, but they kind of complemented it. Those became a belt as well.
And they changed the bonus.
Right, yeah, actually that's probably worth mentioning too. So they actually baked in some damage reduction to the Nat 6 piece, so you get 30% reduced damage for 5 seconds after casting Reign of Vengeance. And then they just reworked the belt completely to so that when you cast Reign of Vengeance, you also summon a crashing beast that deals 3,000 to 4,000% weapon damage. So hopefully that'll help it compete with some of the crazy output that Marauders can do.
Yeah, and I mean it's one of the other things that they did, because Natalia's set was definitely hurting. It was the weakest of all of the sets. The new Unhallowed set was coming very close to Marauders, but Natalia was lagging very far behind. And they've helped to address that with this new set bonus, so that way every time that you use Natalia's the Reign of Vengeance, you get the 300% damage bonus across all of your skills for 5 seconds. And even though it sounds like only 5 seconds, just throwing that together when we were doing our brief stint on the PTR 2 weeks ago, I had it rolling almost 100% uptime.
Oh yeah. Oh yeah. It'll pretty much be permanent.
So it's a 300% bonus damage to everything that you do. So it's going to increase your Reign of Vengeance damage by a considerable amount. The belt is, you know, going to be adding some, you know, I haven't gotten the belt or seen any testing on it, so unfortunately I can't really talk too much about it. But I guess it's going to like appear somewhere in the center of the little Reign of Vengeance circle. So that could be some really nice single target damage, which is one of the things Reign of Vengeance was lacking.
Mm-hmm.
So the, you know, that will be nice. And I really, really want to go through and test this out, because it just seems so interesting. You know, Reign of Vengeance was just one of those skills. It looks so cool and was so crappy.
So yeah, it's like iconic. Yeah. And then like, what does it do though?
Mm-hmm. Yep. And one of the other things that they did to not is kind of like an indirect buff is they changed some of the runes for Reign of Vengeance. There's two that were untouched and three that were changed, where they greatly reduced the duration of the skills but increased the damage to compensate. So instead of doing the damage over 6 seconds, it did it over 3. But mm-hmm. the amount of total damage that it did over the duration stayed the same. You know, in the ones that they changed were ones that had very limited, like range of field. They either were a very small area, you know, or, you know, for a very, it was like a small area that it affected that didn't move, wasn't mobile. And so what would happen is a lot of time with those skills is you would go through, you would use it. An enemy would get hit by like one blast of it and then would keep moving, and the other 5 seconds is completely wasted. And so you don't actually do the entire skill's damage to any enemies in the area. You're only getting like one tick.
Right.
So by going through and greatly reducing the duration, you're putting more damage into them for that one tick of damage that they take. And that's going to be an indirect buff to those skills and make them more powerful. Now, the two that didn't get changed were, you know, probably the two most used runes on the PTR that they were using. And that's just because it was the two that that just, you know, they didn't really need it. It was, hold on, let me pull the actual names of the runes back up here so that way I can actually give you direct names. But it was Dark Cloud, which actually followed the enemies. So it doesn't really matter too much about how much damage or how much damage it's doing over or how long the duration is, because it's going to do the full scope of damage over it and it's always going to hit something. It is one of the smaller ones, but because it will always find a target, you're always doing damage. The other one was Shade, which takes up almost the entire screen. So it doesn't really need, you know, its duration changed because it's going to be hitting everything anyways.
Right.
But the Stampede, Anthem, or Anathema, and Flying Strike, you know, those were all ones that just, they kind of hit just a very small location. And so they now will do that damage over much shorter periods of time. Mm-hmm. They'll be much, you know, this one will kind of be better for, you know, elite killing, boss killing. Not as good for clearing out massive packs of mobs, but that will be there for if you need to like kill those mobs quickly.
Right on. Yeah, something that they also changed too, which is really cool, is some of the skills that are channeled but have movement, so like Strafe, Whirlwind, which obviously was a big skill that's seeing a lot of attention for barbs right now because of their set, but also just because of the AoE capability of it, and because everyone loves Whirlwind, because you'd be crazy not to. They actually made them so that you can cast skills after you stop using that Strafe or Whirlwind or whatever have you a bit sooner. And I think the main direction for that, especially thinking about Whirlwind for barbs, was to make that interaction between Whirlwinding and Rending a little smoother, you know, to mm-hmm. make it so that it's not going to feel like, okay, I come to a complete stop. Now I rend stuff. Now I get back up. Just, you know, it's kind of a clunky gameplay. So I'm hoping that that change should help to smooth that set and the way that it operates out a little bit. But that said, I think the IK set is still taking the cake for the best rework for barbs right now. And some of the people in chat were actually talking about combining it with Raycor and whatnot could actually lead to some really interesting builds. And Wyatt Cheng was actually on Twitter earlier today, stating how it's really cool to see some of the best powers of the sets move to that two-piece and that four-piece bonus for the express purpose of being able to mix and match. Because if you don't go for that full six, you could potentially wear two sets and get to the four-piece of each. and then that can make for some crazy builds. So I feel like right now people are just trying to figure out kind of the best build for the set by itself. And then once we've got all that figured, there's going to be some crazy mixing and matching. I'm really excited for that theory craft session.
Yeah, that was one thing that I was doing. Just so you know, going back to our little PTR session, I was using the 4-piece bonus of Marauders, while I was waiting for the 6-piece bonus of Natalia's. So I
Right.
was having, so I was being able to go through and spam sentries while keeping up Reign of Vengeance the entire time.
And that then imagine that could eventually be a thing, you know? Just another way to play. It's super exciting. For my friends who have Crusader specific interests, I did get to go into the PTR last night, and I tested out Roland's with its changes. The only big change that I got was actually for the bracers that are kind of complementary to the set. They tone them down so they don't give you quite as much damage when you're down to those single target scenarios, and they don't return. They only return 25% of the cost of Shield Bash. So the thing is that it doesn't even really matter because A, the set still puts out a crap ton, a metric ton of damage. Like you can still get billion crits for sure, even without restraint and focus operating the way that they used to, because those got changed as well for this patch. But with the right combo of skills, I'm hoping to put together a highlight video of this thing because you can keep your wrath up pretty much indefinitely, and you can just shield bash everything and CC everything and just be a wrecking machine. So I think Rollins is more than poised to take the cake and nine ball something for you. I got to test out your favorite corrupted Ashbringer.
Oh, very nice.
That thing is crazy.
Yeah, I'm expecting that one. How often does it do you get the procs on it? Like, how often are you getting that 6,000% weapon damage bonus going?
Feel like they could do something to make it more obvious, unless I just don't know what to look for yet. Because you do get a counter at the top left that shows the skeletons that you have with you. And so I was watching that, and then eventually that counter would go away. So I would assume, okay, I must be in the proc now of the 6,000. But I couldn't really see. I guess we'd have to just pay attention to the numbers and the ticks to see when it was actually up and when it wasn't. Because I don't know, it wasn't super obvious. But there were also a lot of things flying around.
Yeah, that would be the one question that I would have, just knowing what I do about the weapon itself. Did you have it transmogged?
I did not.
Okay. That would be something to look for, like almost, I'd think, like on the weapon itself.
It does change. It
Yeah.
does. You're right. So I guess, yeah, that would probably be the biggest cue is just to see, like, oh, it's now glowing a whole different color and everything.
That was actually something I believe that they talked about on the Play Your Way stream about how that they can go and make changes, to the UI with showing like buffs and debuffs. That might be something, that they can think of showing some other way of showing that this proc has happened on your screen.
Especially because they're adding a lot of items similar to that that kind of give you a conditional proc for a shorter period of time or anything like that. So I mean, at some point, it's how much clutter is there? And I think right now we still have the limit of 8 buffs. So, you know, expressing all those and then being in a party as well, like you might not be able to see it. But I don't know, it was awesome. It was a really cool weapon.
I guess moving on from there is some of the things that they had for Witch Doctors.
Yes.
They're changing the Zunimasas around. They're kind of flipping the set bonuses around. So now your fetish army lasts until they die is your 2-piece set bonus. So you no longer have to worry all the way until the 6-piece. The 4-piece set bonus, it's you and your pets take 2% reduced damage for every fetish that you have alive. So that's kind of like your survivability right there. Because I could, that's something that I notice even, around the Greater Rift 30 area, that you're depending upon the affix of the elite packs that you're fighting, your fetishes can die really quickly. Because they just sit there and they take damage. So even with high toughness, even with the 25 the level 25 bonus from Enforcer, when if they're standing right on the center of an orbiter or inside of a poison like a poison stream or a defile, your number is going to be ticking down for like 15 to 5 in just a few seconds. So just even more damage reduction on your pets, is going to keep your DPS rolling at its maximum efficiency there for longer periods of time. And then they went through and buffed the 6-piece set bonus, which, you know, was making it so your mana, whenever you used a mana spender, the enemy took 100% more damage from your pets for 4 seconds. They upped that to 150%. So we'll see if that is enough to, you know, make it compensate with, you know, just because normally what like a pet doctor does is they're not using any Zunimasas. Sometimes they'll use the they'll use the 6-piece bonus in order to keep the fetish army up and alive, but only if you have a star metal Kukri. Otherwise, they're just using, or actually, once you have a star metal Kukri, you don't need the 6-piece bonus. You know, it's because you're gonna be having it up every time. You know, by the time that your fetishes die, your cooldown is reset on Fetish Army, and you just go through and summon a new one. And you're just going through and using Ogchilds, you know, for the elite damage bonus, and that's it. So this will hopefully be able to compete with that, and you'd actually want to go through and, you know, use the whole set. That's the hope. The other one that they made some changes to was Jade Harvester. They completely changed the 2- and 4-piece set bonuses, because it used to be like just the boring, you know, plus intelligence and plus mana per second. And they're changing it now to where when you cast Haunt, if the enemy's already affected by Haunt, it deals 5 seconds worth of damage. So it actually, if the enemy already has Haunt on it, you're going through, you cast it again, it's a direct damage spell now at this point. And, you know, going through, and you can spam cast it, because it's a quick cast, it barely costs any mana. And you can really get the damage really high, especially when using a Quetzalcoatl. If 5 seconds doesn't seem like a lot, that can still be a significant amount of damage. And the 4-piece set bonus makes it so that way now your Soul Harvest gains the effect of every rune. So that in and of itself is going to be, you know, a direct buff to the set. Is now is going to last longer. It does damage. It, you know, you regain health. You know, it's just going to be a nice little tack on of something that was like, maybe they should have given you that option a while ago. You know,
maybe.
But yeah, so some nice little changes. You know, they're talking about how they wanted to add some buffs into Jade Harvester. And I guess not really a set change, but two items. The Haunted Girdle is the new legendary belt that they're adding in, you know, for the Jade Harvester set. Makes it so that way every time that you cast Haunt, it releases one additional spirit. So now if you're using the Restless Spirits, you're casting 3. Or Resentful Spirits, you're hitting 3 targets every time that you cast Haunt, so you're able to, you know, get your damage, you get your dot up and rolling on everything, so you can jump straight into you know, hitting the Soul Harvest and then hitting Haunt again now as your filler in between Soul Harvest to just kind of keep things rolling and keep the damage going.
Right on.
Yep.
Yeah, there's so much here. It seems like with every patch you just introduce even more stuff. We got a lot of the items that were in the game but not documented in the patch notes from last time around. Those now are in the patch notes as well, so they might be new to you. But at least one thing that I tested, if you recall, we were talking about the Nagel Ring last time, which summons a fallen lunatic. That actually works on your follower, so that could be a cool way to add some DPS to your follower. And also still get magic find from them too. Ooh.
Yay!
Shinies, more shinies.
You're 10% of 25% you get from your follower.
Precisely. Mm-hmm. So did we want to dig into any others from here or move into our feedback section? Which you have a few items there.
Yeah, I guess there's one other thing, is just going through and touching on wizards. They did go through to make some changes to Delseers. The new set that they're adding in, they basically just buffed a lot of numbers. So the 2-piece set bonus now, instead of, you know, when you use skills, it lowers the cooldown by 2 seconds instead of 1 second.
Mm-hmm.
They also upped the damage, so that way slow time now does 2,000% weapon damage every second as opposed to 1,250. And then the 6-piece set bonus is now you do 750% more damage to enemies affected by slow time instead of 500. So they're going through, they're trying to make it work because that was another set that was just underperforming on the PTR, and so they really want to make it better. They really want to make it, compete with Firebirds, so that way you actually have some options.
Right, but which is hilarious because they're still making Firebirds better too. You can see, I actually have it up on the screen for people. The four set bonus got changed so that fire, not even just signature spells anymore, but fire spells cause up to three enemies to explode. And now they deal 400% up from 250. So it's like you're raising the bar, and then you're also trying to like have Del Seers compete with that too. But it's like, why keep improving Firebirds? I don't even understand. It's crazy.
Who knows? Who
I guess we just need to get to the point where Wizard is Master Race, you know?
knows? And just the one other thing that I wanted to mention
Please.
is the BlizzCon Elemental Ring. It did finally get a name.
It does have a name now.
So it is no longer the BlizzCon Element Ring. It is called the Convention of the Elements.
I get it.
You get it? Yes, that's a good one. Kudos to the team on that one. I like it.
That is very nice.
Well.
All right. Well, for more of those patch notes, of course, again, you can always visit good old diablo.blizzpro.com. See them all in full. We barely even scraped the barrel. We maybe made it through half of the barrel there, so lots and lots of goodies to look forward to again.
There is, I guess, two other things I did want to note before we move away from the topic of patch notes.
Yes.
Still nothing on Cursed Realms.
Yeah.
No, there was, from what I saw in the Datamine patch notes, there was no changes to any of those strings. So there's not any development that at least has been going on it. So I'm wondering if this is just, this really is just a devil's hand. Type thing that's just experimenting.
I love how that's going to be the term for anything that just doesn't make it or gets like transformed.
It's the StarCraft ghost of Diablo 3. It's they went through, they spent some time and effort going and making this new game mode, and then just decided, it doesn't work, move on.
Yep, we're done with this.
So,
We'll
but
see. It could be something they turn on, you know?
hey,
It's
it
part of
could be
season three.
something, maybe. Could be something that's going out further, patch 2.3, season 4, expansion 2, who knows?
Only time will tell.
Speaking of expansion, going off topic from Diablo for a little bit, there's just one other thing that they added into the D3 PTR patch, and that was they data mined the skin of a probe pet. So they went through, and the strings go through and call for it. It is the Legacy of the Void Collector's Edition is going to give you a little Protoss probe pet for Diablo 3.
Oh, I might have to get that.
And so it's one of those ones. It's kind of interesting. It's not, not really big news for Diablo 3 unless you really like pets and want something other than the little skeletal dog following you around. But that is pretty interesting that they're adding in strings for the collector's edition of StarCraft 2 already, because I mean that the beta hasn't even started for Legacy of the Void.
That is kind of curious. Makes you wonder how far away is LOTV.
I would expect it to be out sometime this year.
For sure.
Is it? Because they've done, they've done StarCraft 2 and Heart of the Swarm, kind of like midway through the year. So it's strange that they haven't started the beta for Legacy of the Void by now, unless they have, or they're going to have a very, very short testing on that one. But it'll be interesting to see.
Indeed, indeed. All right. Well, I guess from there we can move into our community generated feedback section. That's the new theme that I gave it. If you would like to contribute to this section, please feel free to email us. We love your emails. That's westmarchworkshop@blizzpro.com. You can also tweet at us, and that's at the WM Workshop on Twitter. And actually, I'd like to also promote the in-game community, which actually gets pretty lively from time to time. It's just Westmarch Workshop. You can search for it on the live servers, And, you know, if you just want to hang out, you still stay in your clan, meet some people who love the show, who love Diablo, it's a great place to be. All right. I wanted to highlight an email from someone who's actually in chat. Good old Mikey, who likes to grind our gears each and every day.
Good old Mikey.
Good old Mikey. He sent in a picture and he writes an email that says, "Found three goblin packs right next to each other in the same rift today. Hadn't seen anything like that before, so I thought it was interesting. Ended up being 42 goblins in total with 8 legendaries. And in that entire mess, there were no blood thieves, which is interesting. So I have a
So
screenshot.
he has my luck in finding blood thieves then.
Yeah, it sounds like it. He adopted your skills there. And you'll see on your screen at some point this ridiculous. I actually had to break it into
It's
two images.
it is huge. It
That's.
is huge.
I don't like that. I feel like that's like a server error. Like, how would that ever happen? Unless Mikey hacked it. I'm not sure I trust him.
It is Mikey after all.
It's like, I want to be cool. But yeah, pretty
The
awesome.
screenshot was actually taken from like the Xbox version. He went and hacked it and just, he replaced every single mob in Fields of Misery with goblins.
And then used this, still went back into the PC, used their specific fonts and text and everything.
Yep, that's how much of a hacker he is.
Crazy dedication. Thank you, Mikey.
Yeah, thank you very much. Let's see. Mind if I take the next one?
Please.
We got two different emails. I'm going to go and take one of them now from this one, Ed Lad. The first email that, or the second email that he went and sent in is that he's been having fun. He, I guess, kind of tying in from his first one. He's only recently been playing Diablo 3. And he's going through and he's taking it easy. He's only been able to get up to Greater Rift 20 and only just recently is able to complete Torment 5 rifts, but he has to do so very slowly. And he's just wondering, at what point should he run an alt? When is a good point to go through and say that I'm at the point where I can safely go and level up an alternate character? This is softcore. And he pretty much he answers his own question. Is like, would you wait until you have a gem of ease at level 25 and then power level each one? And the answer to that one, in my opinion, at this point in time, is yes. It's like, just go through. He's worried about efficiency. Should I be spending the time grinding paragons and what have you? Get your gem of ease to level 25. By somewhere around that point, you should hopefully have found a decent two-handed weapon, or hopefully an ancient two-handed weapon. And it doesn't really matter too much what the proc is, although I think like the Maximus is probably one of the best ones for power leveling.
Super strong.
It's just to get a two-handed weapon with a lot of damage and obviously a socket. Put the Gem of Ease in there and level your alt. Go through, click that torment, click the difficulty up to like Torment 6, and just face roll everything.
Oh yeah, because it's softcore. Even if you die, it's like just get back in there. Yeah, it's the Gem of Ease like changes the game when you talk about alts and whatnot, because it really opens up the door. As soon as you get that up to 25, like you can make a new character in a matter of hours. Not in some cases, not even. Like if you're doing it on T6, I actually believe it would take less than an hour. So yeah, I feel like as long as you have already, even if you don't feel like you've exhausted that main character that you've decided to play, just a good way to kind of mix it up and then come back refreshed to that main character. You know, take a weekend, level a new one, play around with it, go back to your old main for the week, next weekend, same process.
Do you want to take the next one?
I would love to. I have one here from a good friend of ours, Nerdwords. He
Okay.
is he's in the community, a good member of the community. He does a lot of work for our friends over at Diablo Inc. Gamers. So shout out to those peeps, Flux and the crew. He says, "Hey guys, Nerdwords here. I caught Nineball's memory lapse last episode. How could you forget the crown of the Primus Brother? Luckily, Google exists. I blame it on all the PTR overload that we got." He and this is the reason why I wanted to read this, because Nerdwords is an infamous, we just talked about rolling alts, right? Nerdlords doesn't do that. He just makes 10 wizards, 12 wizards, whatever it takes to max out his character slots. It's wizards. I don't know why. He's crazy. But he says, I'll have you guys know I have finally rolled an alt. A crusader, in fact. And I'm looking for a good fresh level 70, no gear having starter build. Recommendations. I want to make daddy proud. Oh, boy. So, awesome, first of all, that you've decided to break out of the chains of the wizard crew. Starter builds for crusaders. In general, there really isn't any one like crazy build. Like, six skills will do this for you. But I would say pick your favorite generator. Use a blessed hammer. Get some hammers going. And my personal favorite touch to add to like newly leveled to 70 crusaders is to throw phalanx with bowmen in there, because they output great damage, they don't cost any wrath, and the cooldown is relatively short, so they're pretty much up all the time. It's kind of like you get an elite pack, you pop that button, you pop your Akrath's champion, you're good to go. So that's what I would do. And then experiment, play around with some of the other skills, see which you're gonna pick a law. You're going to pick Akarats, and that kind of starts to fill things out. And then you use your passives to kind of supplement whatever skills that you've chosen. If you want to up your phalanx, then you take, what's the skill? I'm going to forget it now. Oh, Lord Commander. Mm-hmm. Indestructible if you don't want to die and it's hardcore, etc. Good stuff. Finery, lots of gems, lots of damage.
Mm-hmm.
So thank you, Nerdwords.
Going on from there, we've got one in from Xavier. And this one, it's continuing on that conversation that's been coming up a lot lately, is just finding some way of improving the Greater Rift Trials. And he went through and has an interesting way. His idea of going through and trying to make it is, when you say give multiple keys and then also like crafting materials. So you have you go through and you give like a X number of trial keys, X number of death's breaths, and then say an imperial through royal gem to unlock higher greater rift keys. So that way, and then it's like, but it will only be able to upgrade it to a certain point, of your max solo greater rift, say minus one.
Right.
So if you can do greater rift 40 is your max, you say you give a small amount of keys, like a single death's breath and like an imperial gem, you can do your max solo rift minus one, or say like minus three or minus five, something along those lines. But if you give more keys and more death's breaths and say like a flawless imperial, you can get up to your current max greater rift. And then also, if you give even more keys, more breaths, and then say a royal gem, you can now do your max greater rift plus one. So if 40 is your max, you can now do 41. And then you just make the gems, correspond with the class. If you're an int class, it's topazes, strength classes, or rubies, dex classes or emeralds. Just so that way it ties in. It uses crafting materials, it uses keys, and it ties in, your actual what rank you can unlock or what rift you can unlock tied to what your actual solo progression already is.
Mm-hmm. Sorry, were you done?
Nope. Yep. Go ahead.
I like this idea, and I like it for multiple reasons. One is that it operates as a sink. And we've been talking about some of our past episodes, a reason for sinks, a reason for a gem sink, because at some point I think they had mentioned they wanted to give us more options on what we could do with our higher level gems, and we haven't seen any of that implemented yet. So this system seems like it would help to feed into that. Xavier touches on the whole idea of death's breath and the fact that they're not really used for much. So this would be a way to sink those. And I think when you think about the... Think about the actuality of what a trial is, right? A Nephilim Rift is the next best thing compared to a Greater Rift. It's just a lower version. And so if you're doing a bunch of those as a trial, you're doing those basically to collect these materials so that you can generate your keys to get to wherever you're trying to get to. So what I would like would be something like this, where you're turning the trial keys basically into a currency. and you use it along with a bunch of other crafting mats and whatnot to generate these keys, and then have the Realm of Trials just turn into a different kind of mini game. And maybe you still use the trial keys to access it, but it gives you a different reward than like a greater rift key or something. The only, sorry, go ahead.
Oh, I was just about to say that another suggestion that Droth just made in chat is, you know, why can't you just like say turn in 10 keys at once? You go through and you complete it, and you get 10 keys to the level that you achieved.
Yeah, I think we've seen that idea. I feel like everyone really likes that one because it's simple, right? Like we keep coming up with all these like extravagant ideas. That one's super simple. I guess it solves that problem of not wanting to do the trials over and over again if you know you can make the key that you want to get to. I think what we also have to solve at the same time is those instances where your build is great for greater rifts, but it doesn't do the Realm of Trials well enough to get you the key that you need.
Yep. So you might have the gear and the spec and everything to go and get, you know, really high rift levels, but you don't have the set that your class needs in order to actually do better in the Realm of Trials. And so you're stuck having to go and do parties in order to get the keys that you need, you know, to get there, you know.
Exactly. Or even the unfortunate circumstance of grinding through like a level 30, starting at 35 and your best is like a 45, and it's like good luck getting back up there, you know. So
Have fun going and spending the next few hours going and getting back up to 45
just to give it a try.
Only just to give it a try and not be able to break your record.
And I mean, it makes sense. I think I've always advocated for, you know, having a build that is specific to the Realm of Trials, similar to what Droth is saying in chat, so that it gives you your best chance at getting the best, the highest level keys that you can manufacture. But some classes and some builds just aren't there. Like, they could be really well thought out builds, but they just don't output the right amount of AoE for what the Realm of Trials requires. And it is such a disconnect from Greater Rifts. I mean, there are no elites in the Realm of Trials, but that's pretty much like what you're fighting in Greater Rifts. So, more to do there for sure. Hopefully, we do see a change to it. This could be our next crusade. We've got the blood shards down. Now we move on to the change of the Realm of Trials.
Our expectations have been met. Now we move on.
Oh, look at that. Looping back. Talk about self-references.
Yeah, talking about self-references.
All right, let's see. There was another thingamajigger. Yes, here from Mr. Dorcas. He says, it seems to me with Season 2 going right now that the season-only achievements are quite useless. They don't appear anywhere. I completed it all in Season 1, and the best it does is add to your total achievement points you got during the season. He wants to confirm if this is true, and if it is, why is there no point to grinding them unless you want to be the top 1,000 for total achievement points for the season? I didn't look into this, so I'm not sure. I know for certain that you can earn them again within the season, but I guess what he's saying is that they're not different from the ones that you get after the... They're not different once they roll over, so like, what's the point of grinding them again in the season?
Yeah, it's just for your total amount of achievement points on your actual like non-season account. It doesn't matter. You've already unlocked them. They're just there. And from what it seems, it's just there for you to go through and collect again if you want to get in that top 1,000 leader board for the achievement points, and that's it.
Yeah, and I mean, that's a fair purpose, because you need to have a leaderboard that kind of represents all player interests, and so you have the one that's kind of there for those players that are super gear oriented, want to min-max, etc., and those are your standard leaderboards. And then you have one for people who love achievement hunting, and that's that achievement leaderboard. You have your conquest, which is like a even greater level of that, and it just makes sense to have multiple offerings, because not everyone's bag is you know, equipping the highest level of gear and rolling their face against, you know, greater rift 50 forever, etc.
One of the last ones that we have here is from Josh. He goes through and wanted to go and say that he sees the Ring of Royal Grandeur debate resurface every few days, and it's something that, you know, again, this is one of those ones, it's a common complaint, and just wanted to kind of take his stab at it. It was just that you have like kind of like a baked in ancient set bonus, where if a certain number of your set pieces are ancient, it reduces the set bonus by one, but can't stack with the Ring of Royal Grandeur. So it replaces it if you've grinded enough, so that way you have five pieces of your set ancient. So it frees up that ring slot, so you're not kind of like tied into, enslaved by the Ring of Royal Grandeur.
Hmm. I don't know. What do you think?
That's one that's interesting. You know, I guess it would just be, I'm wondering, with the changes that they've been making to, so that way more of the power is baked into the earlier set bonuses and not the later set bonuses, of you know, what you might be going through and saying, you know, do I really need this Ring of Royal Grandeur? You know, or can I just run with a 4-piece and skip the 6-piece set bonus?
Right, and it only gains extra importance when you're trying to do like the dual wield, if you will, of two sets to get both of their 4-pieces or something like that.
Mm-hmm.
So yeah, it's I guess that is a good point with the re-emphasizing, I guess, of the powers of the sets moving to the lower tiers. It might be that we don't see the Ring of Royal Grandeur having as much importance, but I think when you think about the idea of combining multiple set bonuses from different sets, that does put the Ring of Royal Grandeur back on a pedestal. So to me, I don't like the idea of trying to remove it. I think it's still a thing that should exist, because it's an item that everyone A, wants, and B, everyone can find. So it just adds like another grind to the game. But I don't know, I would rather see them pursue some of the changes that we were bandying about, you know, moving it to maybe a world drop or to different bounties or acts or whatever have you.
Yep. And then the other thing that he added on there was a PS, congrats on the flavor text nod.
Is that the tall man, little man thing?
No. You didn't see?
No, what? You have
I have something for you.
What?
Go back to the picture of Bane of the Stricken.
What did I... All right, hold on here, guys.
Hee hee.
We're doing some investigating, and I feel like I'm about to be very salty / jealous. All right, after the defeat of Malthil, I can't read. Diadra the Scholar?
Scholar.
Wow. The Scholar. Yep. Wandered the world. She studied the gem cutters of Zansai and brought their secrets back to Westmarch. Bane of the Stricken is the first gem to come out of her Westmarch workshop. What? Ballin'.
Yeah, we got in the game, people.
Oh, snap.
Oh, look at that.
Dude, that's badass. People heard me read at the fifth grade level there, too. It was exciting.
Yep.
Dude, sweet.
Yeah.
All right.
So somebody on the development team there actually listens to the show, apparently.
Well, we know Wyatt does.
Yeah, we know.
And we're still, Wyatt, if you're listening right now, we're still waiting for you to answer, what would you rather face?
Yeah. What is it the gargantuan-sized zombie dog or the three zombie dog-sized gargantuans?
That's
the
right.
World needs to know.
Inquiring minds.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. But still, yeah, that little thing. I didn't notice this until yesterday. And I hadn't seen Hugh mention anything about it when we were communicating back and forth, so I was hoping to hold on to that one just a little bit there.
Shows you how much flavor text reading I do. But I do usually read them eventually. It's just not the first thing I go to when an item is new.
Yep.
Oh, that's too funny. Apparently, Brandy is saying there's more. There's a few of them.
I'll have to go digging for that one.
Right. Find all the Easter eggs, people, and send them to us.
Yes.
I did want to quickly just touch on this last feedback that we had. It came from Cap'n Crunch, the most delicious cereal in the world. The Cap'n wrote in, and he said that he had a post on Reddit, so then I went to Reddit, and he's talking about amulets. And his, or her, because, you know, who's to assume... their gripe with amulets right now is that they roll with some predetermined things that are just not useful. So you'll see, for instance, one that comes to mind for me is that this Zephyrian amulet rolls with attack speed. And right now it's like not useful for the majority of the best builds. And it kind of puts that item almost instantly into the dumpster, because you would basically have to have the other three roll perfectly, roll a socket and some other stuff that you care about. And then roll the attack speed off to make it completely useful to you. But the idea here is to possibly have the standard stuff that comes on these, almost said unique, on the legendary amulets, be things that are useful. So like sockets rolling naturally. And this was something that actually kind of reminded me, Nineball, of your idea where you were saying maybe a Romolani's gift for jewelry that just puts a socket on there. Maybe this helps to alleviate that issue of, oh God, all I want is a socket and it's impossible to find one with a natural one or to roll it on there. So.
Yeah, I mean, it's just again, it just comes down. I've been on the soapbox so many times. Just my point is, you know, it when the when a certain affix is this mandatory that it will say that this item is, you know, godly or garbage because of a single affix, then something has to be done. You know, just. We need some way of going through and adding in those sockets, you know, to it instead of having to go through and roll it, because we're always going to be coming down to that decision. And, you know, a lot of times it really comes down to at the higher gear levels, well, I'm just going to completely get rid of the main stat and roll a socket.
Right.
And so you have all these things that are better than main stats, which, you know, kind of, you know, it's like, well, why call it a main stat if it's my worst stat, you know?
That's true. And I think in terms of like rarity, because of course they did make some of the rarest items no longer quite as rare. But that being said, even if those items are dropping more plentifully, I don't even know if that's right, but if they're coming more often, and they're still rolling crappily, it doesn't matter if you can find more of them. If they're not getting the rolls, then they still have not as much use to you. So I think for instances when you're looking for a specific SOJ and you're just not getting the right element, if you have more guarantees that other parts of it are rolling well, basically just helping to combat all the RNG, make some of it more static and favorably static, just to kind of help curve that out. Because I know for like for me, when I get to the end of my builds, when I'm almost there, it's usually like an SOJ that needs to roll with a socket or like a perfect 8% CDR or something.
And then at that point, I mean, when you're going and fishing for an upgrade, you have to have the stars have to align because they have to have all of these, and the stats have to be better.
Nope. And that is the end of our submitted feedback for this week.
Do we have any items?
Of course, we have items.
Okay, all right.
I told you I'm making the items of the week their own like special thing now because they need that.
Okay,
They need
I'm sorry. I'm sorry.
that. Don't be sorry. Just be thankful.
Just be thankful. Sorry, sorry.
Right, let's see. Let me find this. All right. This one you actually submitted from someone else, which is cool. This is a Twitter submission from at JMayBoy, and it's an ancient Kreider shot. And I actually believe his text was, "Do you like my Kreider shot?" or something to that effect.
Yes,
To which I want to respond, "Yes, I do."
and my response that when he went through and sent that in was that should be made illegal.
It
That is too good.
really is,
Oh my
though.
gosh, that thing is
Let
beautiful.
me hit you people with some stats. We have 3,344.2 DPS. 10% damage rolled innately onto this. 996 dex. He rerolled a 7% attack speed on there, interestingly enough. And then threw on the Ramala. I was trying to think of a really clever way to say it again. A Rhymadama, a Slamanama on there for the socket for 130% critical hit damage. And this is on the console. But it looks legit because this is possible.
Yep, no, that's legit. That is definitely legit. All those stats go through and check out. And he plays on the Xbox One.
Oh, sweet. Okay. Yeah, not too shabby. I still haven't found a Kreider shot, and I remember when it first was introduced, that was like the only item I wanted.
Yeah, you know, everyone's favorite build was Ball Lightning. You know, back before Reaper of Souls, and even going into Reaper of Souls, it ended up being everyone's favorite build, whether they wanted it or not. That's all because of, you know, I guess the high-end builds. It wasn't because of the Kreider shot, but that was it. Just awesome, awesome mechanic.
Oh, for sure. I would really like to see the drop rate of these buffed for my Crusader. All right, moving on. I'm just kidding. I realize at some point I'll actually have to play the DH again if I want to find one. We're looking at A submission from good old Mad Hamster. Hadn't heard from you in a while, bud. Glad to see you throwing items back our way. This is an ancient Stone of Jordan, and it's for our Dex loving classes. It's got 19% lightning elemental damage going on here, 630 Dex, and a perfect 30% elite damage. And he rerolled an affix to get a socket on here, kind of harkening back to the thing we were just talking about. And of course, if you're playing a monk, you got your 209 fire resistance as a secondary, so that's always good news.
Yeah, that definitely that's a huge benefit to a monk.
Without a doubt.
Mm-hmm.
So thank you, Matt Hamps, for that submission. We will move right along onto this Eye of Etlich, and this one is submitted by Triumph. He also submitted two other items that were on the PTR, and they were decent, but I at least wanted to keep it to the live realms here. And this item is also insane. Eye of Etlich is a really good item just because the secondary actually reduces damage from ranged attacks by quite a bit. I think 35% is the max. This one has 33.8%. But basically, the benefit you're getting from this is it's a reduction to many of the most dangerous affixes that elites throw at you. A lot of them classify as ranged damage. So this is huge. The rest of the stats on here are light, another 19%, funny enough. Lightning elemental boost. A perfect 100% critical hit damage roll on there. And also came with the innate socket. This is just crazy. And then he rerolled critical hit chance on here for 10%.
Yep.
Beautiful.
So, I mean, that is... I wish I had one of those.
Right?
Yeah.
Yep. The jealousy is real.
The jealousy is real, especially when that's one of the things I've been spending all of my Forgotten Souls on lately, is going and trying to reroll the critical hit damage higher on a couple of my items, and, you know, most of the times that it goes through and rolls back up, it's like 26%. I was like, no.
Why?
No. Yeah.
Why you do this? It's already such a, it's one of the rarer affixes to get when you're rerolling too, and then to get those low values, slap in the face. And I should comment that there also is a secondary resist on here, which is the 154 lightning resistance. So good stuff all around. This is our last submission, actually. And this comes from Chris Mag. It's an ancient incense torch of the Grand Temple. Gotta love it. 4,281.4 DPS. Rerolled the 10% damage affix on there. 1,302 dexterity. Quite a bit. An interesting affix here. Increased damage against elites by 9%. Decided to leave that on. And then wave of light damage increased by 26%. Reduce the spirit cost of wave of light by 40%. And then some max spirit as a secondary. Of course, Ronald McDonald's goody two shoes hamburger deal for a socket. I'm sorry.
don't be. Sorry, not sorry.
Sorry, not sorry.
Yep. Yeah, that is definitely probably one of the, that's one of the, you know, like the, this is like the hot item, you know,
oh,
of
yeah.
the season. Everyone of course wants some furnaces, but this is like the hot item for monks at the moment, and there's so many monks going out there.
Monks are so hot right now.
They're so hot right now.
Damn that Hansel.
Did you see that they actually like performed at an actual like fashion show? For
what?
The finale.
Like,
yeah.
Like actually doing turns and stuff?
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, that, so hot.
So hot right now. That brings us to the end of our show, if you couldn't tell. It's been real. Episode 42. Patch 2.2. The answer for everything.
The answer for everything.
But wait, there's... Sorry, go ahead.
Go ahead.
No, I was going to say, but wait, there's more.
I was just going to make a bad joke, so.
No, we love bad jokes on this show, if you couldn't tell.
Uh-huh. We have an answer for everything. Dude. Not always right.
Yes.
Yep.
Agreed. Mm-hmm. All right, and following up on that tough-to-beat, terrible joke, we're going to be doing a contest. Let's move this here. For this guy, this signed collector's edition of Diablo Reaper of Souls. That was so graciously sent over to me from some of our favorite community managers. Maybe it was Brandy. I don't even know.
Who knows?
So, what we're going to do for this is you guys out there in TV land, iTunes, Stitcher land, go ahead and send us submissions for your favorite memories or your favorite moments or favorite, I don't even know, scenario, story, whatever you think will fit the bill from Reaper of Souls, because we're coming up on the 1 year anniversary. It's going to be 2 weeks from today. So we'll actually have a show for it, which is super awesome. And at that show, that's when we're going to decide who the winner is. So you guys have from now, from when you hear this announcement until that show, to get your submissions in, send them to the Westmarch workshop at blisspro.com. It can be a video, it could be a song, a parody, you know we love those. A poem, I don't even know, a play. You could stage it with your friends.
Yeah, machinima.
Yes, why not?
In essay, interpretive dance.
Mmm.
Bongos.
Bongos, I love the sound of drums.
You could mail us an essay written in Braille.
Ooh. Going the extra mile there.
There we go.
Yeah, however, the more creative, the better. We really want to be wild here because this is a pretty sweet item. So let it happen and we'll figure it out. And I'm gonna open it up to all continents, I think, for now. Sure. It could be crazy shipping, but I don't know, whatever. We'll see.
Whatever.
I'll let it ride. So, word, get those in. Mr. Nineball, anything to say before we part? Did we hit everything we needed to hit?
Oh, we hit pretty much everything. I guess the only thing that we did skip, I realized that I left this out of the show notes, that there was the hot fix for live servers.
Oh, yeah.
They're just pretty much it was just something simple. They're continuing to go and crack down on the few outliers of abilities that snapshot stats.
Yes.
And so there's just fixing a couple more of those. So they probably have that almost completely stamped out now. And then otherwise, you just still totally psyched about actually getting, we're part of the game now.
I know, man,
We're
that's really cool.
part of the game.
I'm super stoked on that. Yeah. Good stuff. Again, more good stuff coming. We'll be seeing you guys next week, as we like to every week here on twitch.tv/leviathan111. That's going to be Wednesdays at 9 p.m. Eastern, 6 p.m. if you live on the other coast, that crazy coast. What else? You can send us tweets again. We do like tweets. That's the WM Workshop. We do have the in-game community, Westmarch Workshop, and there's actually one in the EU as well too, so you can check that out. Individually, both of us here, Nineball, follow him on Twitter, Nineball Gamer. Follow myself at SA Stewart 111. Oh man, BlizzPro, diablo.blizzpro.com, all sorts of articles. We got, again, Lieutenant Lunatic, our brand new writer. He's going to be bringing you guys the freshest of the fresh.
Definitely look forward to some of the things that he has to say because the man's got a lot of great ideas.
Absolutely. Yeah, and we just want to hear from you guys. Submit your items. If you're on the PTR, submit anything that you find that you think is cool. Cool builds, cool effects, stuff that's undocumented. Give us the heads up on, would be great. Again, Westmarch Workshop at blisspro.com. Don't forget about the contest, and we'll keep reminding you.
Then looking forward to next week. I'm hoping that we see something for the Reaper of Souls anniversary coming up here in 2 weeks. We haven't heard anything from Blizzard, one way or the other. I guess they kind of briefly mentioned it on the Play Your Way stream, but nothing solid or concrete.
Stay tuned.